Dr. Connie Webster of the Department of Nursing and Health Professions at the University of the District of Columbia. Welcome to Health Matters. Our purpose is to assist you in managing your health care by providing you balanced information and resources to help you make knowledgeable choices about your health. Our topic for this session is maternity care, and my guest is Dr. Stella Akpuaka, an assistant professor in the Department of Nursing and Health Professions at the University of the District of Columbia. She began her nursing education at Cameron University in Lawton, Oklahoma. She earned her bachelor's degree from Bowie State University and continued her graduate studies at the University of Maryland, University College, where she earned the Master of Science in Healthcare Administration, the Certificate in Nursing Education from the University of Maryland School of Nursing, and a Master of Science in Health Services Leadership Management. She recently earned the Doctor of Nursing Practice degree from Carlow University in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Dr. Akpuaka began her teaching career here at the university as a professor of maternal newborn nursing, and she provides clinical coverage for students at Providence Hospital in Washington, D.C., and Johns Hopkins Hospital in Baltimore, Maryland. While her major focus is maternity care, she also has a research interest in prostate cancer prevention. Dr. Akpuaka's most recent research project, however, was entitled A Qualitative Study to Explore the Male Nursing Students' Coping Experiences in a Maternal Newborn Setting. Dr. Akpuaka, welcome to Health Matters.
Thank you, Dr. Webster. I'm glad to be here.
You know, I'm so pleased to have you here. And for most of our viewing audience and for many people who talk about nurses, most people think that a nurse is a nurse is a nurse mm-hmm. is a nurse. And they think that we all do all things. So it is a real pleasure for me to have a nurse who specializes in the field of taking care of moms and new babies. So can you just give our viewers just an overview of what you do as a maternal newborn nurse, and then kind of tell us what you do when you're teaching these young folk how to take care of newborns?
Thank you. The practice of maternal newborn nursing really do depend on nursing education, the specialty, the practice setting mm-hmm. that the particular nurse would like to practice. But for a maternal newborn nurse person, you can either work in a labor and delivery suite.
Labor and delivery.
Or you can work in a postpartum unit, or you can work in the neonatal section, which is the nursery, which right. a lot of people call nursery.
Right. Tell me, and just for our viewers, say postpartum again. Mm-hmm. What does it mean to be postpartum?
Okay, postpartum is after giving
after
birth.
You've done
after, after the mother has carried the entire pregnancy, gone through labor, deliver, give birth, and she's now in a section of the postpartum, which we'll call afterbirth unit, okay. where the mother and the baby recuperate for maybe a couple of days if the mother gave birth vaginally
okay.
or stayed for approximately 3 days if she delivered through C-section.
Which
as long as if they are healthy, if the mother is healthy and the baby is healthy, but they can stay longer if there's complications, either with the mother or with the newborn.
Does the maternal newborn nurse have the opportunity of choosing where she wants to be, or does it depend on just where they're needed during the day?
Well, usually nurses will choose where they would like to be. There are a lot of labor and delivery nurses that do strictly labor and delivery. They work in the laboring suites.
Right.
They don't work in the neonatal nursery, and they don't work in a postpartum unit. So it depends on the interest, what really interests the maternal newborn nurse most.
Yeah.
But a lot of maternal newborn nurses, they are trained and they are oriented, depending on the facility where they're working, to be able to function in these three major areas,
okay.
which is the nursery and taking care of the mother and the baby in the postpartum unit.
Right. Now, I see a lot of young women with their little newborns mm-hmm. or with their nice pregnant tummies. Mm-hmm. Tell me a little bit about what the demographics of your nursery mm-hmm. and your unit looks like. Are there a lot of kind of old women like me, or are they all young women, and how would their care differ?
Okay, the most classic demographics for maternal newborn are the childbearing age, which we consider 15 to 44 years,
15.
Age 15 to 44. Okay. But that does not necessarily mean that we don't have pregnant adolescents under 15 or women over 44 years old.
Right.
Currently, with advent of technology and fertility treatment, we have seen increase and with a lot of women going through education and training, becoming professionals, we have seen a lot of women age 35 up to 44, mm-hmm. the number of them giving birth has increased mm-hmm. in the past decade. And with what I told you, I just stated earlier, technology and fertility treatment, we have seen women in more than 50 year old mm-hmm. give birth. A number of women 50 years and above have given birth in the past decade.
Which age group do you see most frequently in your hospital?
Most frequently, we see age between 15 and 44.
Right. Mm-hmm. Now, my other concern, just talking about the age groups, would be, would the care differ in terms of exactly how you take them through the whole birthing process, mm-hmm. the kinds of things you would tell them after the birth is done? Mm-hmm. How does that care differ for these varied age groups?
Basically, the protocol remains the same, but each individual client gets an individualized plan of care. Mm-hmm. Take for instance, if we have an adolescent or a pre-adolescent, the care and management of this particular individual will depend on the pregnancy itself. Some of them are considered high risk. Some of them,
what does that mean? High risk.
Okay, high risk, pregnancy itself is not a disease. We don't consider pregnancy a disease, and we don't consider pregnancy an illness. It's a normal process of procreation
right.
that takes place. Mm-hmm. But then we have individuals that may have some conditions prior to conception, prior to them getting pregnant,
right.
which for instance, someone that have high blood pressure,
yes.
someone that has been dealing with cardiac disease or asthma or any other health condition, hypertension,
mm-hmm. right.
and they conceive as long as the uterus, the ovaries are functioning,
as long as it
or
works.
They have psychiatric concerns,
yeah.
they can conceive and be pregnant.
Right.
So their care will be specialized and individualized. Those are considered high risk.
Okay.
Or we also have some conditions that we consider gestational onset, which are those health concerns that are brought about by the presence of the pregnancy itself.
Mm-hmm.
Just something like bleeding during pregnancy, or what we call placental abruptio, where the placenta just suddenly we dislodge itself from the wall of the uterus, either
yes.
due to disease process or accident or trauma, or when we have abnormal implantation of the placenta previa, mm-hmm. that creates bleeding, or mothers that are going through preterm labor contraction where the pregnancy itself is threatened, either for whatever condition might be. Mm-hmm. These are what we consider high-risk pregnancies.
High-risk.
And so they get critical observation and management and
mm-hmm.
tests.
Mm-hmm.
So we will have positive outcome for both the mother and the baby.
Now, if I were, let's say, just a layman, and my 13-year-old or my 12-year-old daughter conceived and was pregnant, what kinds of things as her mother or even her father should I worry about? I mean, at one time, adolescent pregnancies came with a certain degree of high risk.
Mm-hmm.
Either the baby was under birth rate or some other things like that. What kinds of things would I have to do as a parent to be concerned about or work with my child mm-hmm. about?
We need to understand both nurses and parents. We need to understand that these adolescents, these young girls, they're still growing.
Right.
they're still maturing. A lot of them have not met, or most of them, almost all of them have not met with their developmental milestones. The pelvic bone is still growing and developing.
Yes.
And a growing fetus, a baby inside the mother's womb, just don't know how old their mother is.
Right.
So they just continue,
they continue to grow.
They just continue to grow. And that's why we have high risks of cesarean deliveries with these pre-adolescents, because mm-hmm. the pelvic and the size of the baby are disproportionate. So they have what we'll call CPD, cephalopelvic disproportionate.
Okay.
Yeah, the baby is bigger than the size of their pelvic bone.
Of their pelvic space.
But the parents themselves, first of all, need to understand that, well, if the young girl is pregnant, it already happened.
Right.
They are already pregnant.
Right.
I mean, maybe the frustration or whatever, the disappointment that this is not what I want my little girl to be pregnant at 13. We cannot continue to beat them down because it already happened. The focus will be to have a positive outcome for that pregnancy, educating the young child as much as her cognitive intelligence can understand, because intellectually they're still developing.
Sure.
Also,
yes.
There's so many things they cannot understand and just take care of. So it still becomes the responsibility of the adult in their life to be part of that pregnancy, to make sure that this young girl follows all the proper regimen.
Yes.
That is outlined by
prenatal.
The physician, prenatal care, especially prenatal care.
Yes.
Take her to the doctor.
Yes.
Don't keep her at home.
Right.
Hoping, well, I want to hide this pregnancy. I don't
right.
want my neighbors to know. I don't want everybody to find out that my little girl is pregnant.
Right.
Because there are too much risks involved with her being very young and with that pregnancy. Just parents should take the courage, begin to have that forgiveness, so to say,
mm-hmm.
Oh, it happened, let's take care of this young girl, let's take care of the pregnancy, take her to the doctor, let her get a complete health assessment.
Right.
A complete health assessment, make sure that she's eating very well,
eating?
Proper nutrition,
yes.
Make sure that she's exercising, don't just keep her in the house, lock her up in the room,
mm-hmm.
She needs to exercise, she needs to hear you go to classes, mingle with other young people her age, because that is also threatened
right.
with the presence of the pregnancy, where they may begin to lose friends,
social
they still
contact.
Lose social contact.
Yes.
Just allow her, just let her be her regular self as much as you're trying to give her some other education for her to understand that there is so much responsibility here.
Associated,
so to say,
yes.
Yes, we have someone coming, a baby that will be taken care of, but before we can get a very healthy baby and a healthy mother, we need to take care of that 13-year-old.
Yes, and I know we're going to take you back into the hospital where you belong when you're trying to help them get delivered,
mm-hmm.
But I would just like to also add that since you talked about how these young girls are still maturing and their bones and all, their vitamin regimens are very, very important, not only to mineralize those little new babies that are forming, but also to sustain themselves
mm-hmm.
as they continue to grow as well. Now, once they get into your unit, whether it's an adolescent mother or whether it's an elder or a more mature person, what kinds of things would you do once you get them into the unit? As the, I guess this is antepartum?
The antepartum, yeah.
Yeah,
the antepartum,
I got it.
You got it.
Yeah.
The antepartum period. Nurses, healthcare providers, first of all, need to establish a good rapport with adolescents. They are very secretive. They won't tell you everything,
uh-huh.
But you need everything they can tell you to give them the perfect, almost the appropriate care that they need.
Okay.
Therefore, we provide them, and nurses, healthcare providers should provide them with non-judgmental care.
Right.
They should be able to separate their feeling about adolescent pregnancy and conception and keep it away, and now realize that this individual needs my care. Provide her with non-judgmental care, a complete assessment.
Mm-hmm.
We ask so many questions.
Yes.
Part of our assessment is not just physical examination. We ask a lot of questions, social questions about relationship, sexual transmitted infections, use of drugs, intimate partner violence. Mm-hmm. We go deeper into data collection that has to do with serious personal information that a lot of people wouldn't want to share with anybody. And therefore, if you don't have a good rapport where you maintain respect, although they're young, their adolescents, they do deserve respect too.
Absolutely.
They should not be disrespected. Mm-hmm. So providing them non-judgmental care and giving them respect and making them understand that the reason you are asking these questions and why I need this is to help me take better care of you. So I need you to tell me the truth and everything. And once you are able to develop and achieve that rapport and understanding where she trusts you, that is the basic of your success. That's your basic. Mm-hmm. And so with that, get into the physical assessment and monitoring, mm-hmm. the pregnancy, mm-hmm. laboring. Mm-hmm. And if they come in when they are already in labor, then we follow the protocol for them to go through the stages of labor and delivery, mm-hmm. and pain management. Mm-hmm. Pain management is a big one.
What kind of things would you identify for women who are pregnant, whether they're adolescents or a more mature mom? What kinds of things would you tell them to look out and feel for to know that it's about time that I move out and start to the hospital? I should say fathers as well.
Fathers, of course, we need them. They are part of what we do.
Yes.
For each pregnant mother, she'll be able to understand their body,
yes.
and pay attention to the changes, both physiologically, emotional changes, mm-hmm. that is going through in their body. Mm-hmm. Depending on the gestational age, mm-hmm. really, there's never a time through pregnancy that bleeding is acceptable.
So bleeding is not...
Bleeding is never acceptable during pregnancy at any gestational age, no
okay.
matter how many weeks or months pregnant
okay.
the mother is, she shouldn't bleed.
Okay.
She shouldn't have any vaginal bleeding. So
okay.
if that occurs at any time, they need to get to the hospital. They
okay.
need to go to the hospital, call their healthcare provider and get to the hospital. And there are some signs and symptoms that we also watch out. If the water broke,
okay.
like the amniotic fluid, when
yeah.
they have gush of water from the vagina,
yeah. uh-huh.
that is not urine. Because,
yeah.
you know, we have incontinence, just
yes.
stress, a little bit of stress
a
incontinence.
Stress incontinence with this fat baby growing.
You know, where
yeah.
the baby
okay.
growing.
Uh-huh.
If that is not, if they're sure that this is not just a little bit of urine trickling out, if it's a ruptured membrane, that the water broke, they need to get to the hospital.
Okay.
They need to get to the hospital. And earlier in the pregnancy, any baby that is born under 37
mm-hmm.
weeks,
mm-hmm.
if they have not completed the 37 weeks, they are considered premature.
Premature.
Right. Mm-hmm. So any time from the beginning until age 37 weeks, if there's contraction, cramping, she needs to call her healthcare provider and come to the hospital for assessment to make sure that she's not going into early labor.
Right.
But then from age 38, gestational age 38 weeks and above, if she starts having some little discomfort, some little pains that comes and go, she still needs to watch it and then call healthcare provider and explain what is going on. We'll have conversation just to see if she's really getting ready to go into labor. What signs have they seen? Any mucus plug, you know, things,
mm-hmm.
or what do
whatever.
They feel as the baby moved down further into the birth canal and little things like that. A few questions that they may be asked just to see, maybe they're going into labor. Go ahead and work. There's something we'll call Braxton Hicks contractions.
Yes.
And true labor.
Yeah.
Yeah, with Braxton Hicks, which
just
is false
yeah.
labor.
Yeah.
Yeah, they may start having contractions, but once you tell her, okay, get up and walk around, see if the contraction continues
mm-hmm.
or if it goes away,
mm-hmm.
then sometimes they go away. Most times, false labor will stop with exercise and moving around.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. But true labor, the more she walks, the more she walks around, the stronger the contraction becomes.
Okay, moms.
And so, yeah, time
all
it
right.
and how often are they coming. Then they can come into the hospital for further assessment.
Now, you made a statement earlier that I think we need to reflect on again. First of all, generally, a maternity population is a healthy population. It is not usually a sick population. So if a young woman starts to notice that she's having swelling or shortness of breath or anything, those kinds of things, what are their, are those concerns for things that she or he or her family should be worried about?
Yes, there's a specific amount of weight gain that is expected for a pregnant woman. Mm-hmm. A normal female that has maintained her normal body weight as expected according to her height is expected to gain a total of 25 to 35 pounds throughout her whole pregnancy. And at the beginning, she should really gain 1 to 1.5 pounds
okay
per month.
Okay.
In that fashion.
Okay.
But if she has gained too much weight, if a mother gained, let's say, 5 pounds in a week, 10
yes.
pounds in
yeah.
a week, that's a bit much.
That's
when you
concern.
Are expected to gain a maximum of 35 pounds in
for
a nine-month
period, yes.
and here you have gained 10 to 15 in a month,
mm-hmm.
then you look at that and say, okay, what's going on here? And shortness of breath, as the pregnancy progresses, early in the pregnancy, because the fetus is still coming up and pushing up on the diaphragm,
yeah.
there's not shortness of breath in the early pregnancy stage, like mm-hmm. the first and second trimester.
Mm-hmm.
But in the third trimester, when the fetus has grown and pushing up on the diaphragm, there's a little bit, not much. It shouldn't be excessive shortness of breath,
right.
but a little bit of, you know, hyperventilation, just minute, that is not noticeable.
And doesn't but prevent you from doing anything.
No, it shouldn't prevent the mother from doing anything. But when you can notice shortness of breath, now then she needs to come in to be evaluated
right.
for shortness of breath and excessive weight gain. Because that, we're looking at that also as maybe leading to some other complications.
Some other toxic conditions. Mm-hmm. And we also use the blood pressure as a parameter. If there are sudden spikes in blood pressure. And I do know also that during pregnancy, some women can start to exhibit signs of diabetes, gestational diabetes. So going to a healthcare provider is why it's so important to stay on top of all of these things. Now, while we got the moms all straightened out, another concern for me would be, what do you do with these little bitty babies? And especially for adolescent moms, what kinds of things would a newborn nursery nurse be sure of before they turn this little bitty baby loose with this little bitty mother?
Yeah. Each newborn is assessed. Really, assessment and planning for the care of the newborn starts while the baby is still inside the mother,
right.
is still in utero.
Yeah.
The gestational age, how many months or how many weeks the baby was prior to its being born, has a lot to do with the care and management that the baby received. Like I said earlier, babies born at under 37 weeks, they're considered premature, and they face a lot of challenges. And most babies, all of them, term, mm-hmm. preterm, they have things that we anticipate.
Yes.
But for the premature babies, respiration, mm-hmm. establishing respiration. And for
how
babies that are termed,
slow they breathe
okay,
or whatever, yeah.
They need to breathe.
Yes.
And for the fact that they need to breathe is one reason why when they are premature, we worry too much. Because the placenta, while the baby is still inside the mother, the connecting link between the baby and the mother, the placenta, the umbilical cord.
Yes.
Okay. The baby gets oxygen.
The baby
gets nutrients.
Yes.
Every goodies.
Yes.
Goes to the baby.
Yeah.
From there. But once the baby comes out, we clamp the umbilical cord. The baby is on his or her own,
yeah.
and therefore they need to immediately establish respiration.
Mm-hmm.
They need to start breathing on their own in order for them to survive outside of the uterine cavity.
Mm-hmm.
So that becomes the number one, the main thing for them to establish respiration.
Right.
And so we suction them. When they are inside the mother, it's like a little fish in the water.
Right.
So they have fluids, they're living in water. So once they are born, we suction their mouth and their nose in order for them to be able
to take that
first gasp and start breathing.
Right.
So once they have we have established respiration and there's no concern for respiration, the next thing is thermoregulation. They have to regulate their body temperature.
Right.
So all of them.
So you wrap them in these
We clean them up because they're in water. They are wet when they are born. So we clean them up and make sure that the skin is dry. And take it from there and what they have to regulate that body temperature. But some of them that are not able to regulate their body temperature, we continue to keep them under the radiant warmer, put them in the incubator, just let them sit there until their body temperature is regulated, where we can have them in an open air room temperature, and they still have to maintain that temperature. Because their body temperature, they're human, their body temperature should be normal, you know, right. Conversant like 98.6, just like our own, up to 99.5.
I'm going to give you the opportunity to leave some words of wisdom to women who may be pregnant right at this moment in terms of things that they should be concerned about. But before we leave, I think it would be remiss if we didn't talk about the bonding process. And knowing that, having been a mom in that situation myself, you try to get other children and the whole family involved in that bonding, even as the mom is going through delivering that baby. So for any pregnant mom, you have the last word. What would you say to a mother who is with child right now, whether she's an adolescent mom or a mature mother?
I will advise all pregnant mothers to make sure that they have already started prenatal care. It is very, very important for every pregnant woman to seek and gain prenatal care, early access, start early. If they haven't started already, start today. Call a healthcare provider today to start prenatal care, because it helps us identify care that the pregnant mother might need when they come in to deliver. We do a lot of blood tests. We look for so many issues that might create complications, concern for both the mother and the baby. They need to go for prenatal care. If they have started getting prenatal care already, they need to follow the instructions that they were provided by their primary care physicians. Eat, exercise, avoid infections, avoid violence.
Okay. You got it, mothers. And take good care of yourself. When you take good care of yourself, you take good care of your baby. Health Matters is a television series created to assist you in managing your health care. If you would like more information about the topic of this program or the University of the District of Columbia Department of Nursing and Health Professions, please visit our website at www.udc.edu. I'm Dr. Connie Webster. Thank you for watching, and remember, your health matters.